Old Hara's first impression of New York, seen from a VIP window of Concord, was that he had been transported back in time. Instead of the promised city of the future, the skyscraper landscape reminded him of the 1930s, King Kong, angels with dirty faces, and Tom Mix's Stetson. It actually gave him a new hope. Its antiquity made it seem contemporary with the Hitler he remembered. Although he'd been born in New York, America, in 1377 Hankamer Street, Brooklyn, he had no recollection. When he was three, his family had immigrated to Ireland. During his teens, he had joined the Black and Tans. When the family had resettled across the channel in Ull in Lancashire, the experience he gained with the Irish movement had proved useful to Mosley. Hara looked up at the muggy and oppressive sky. Yes, maybe he was pleased to be home. A long sigh eased from him. Quietly under his breath, he whispered, "Forever England." His dry voice wrapped around the words, "Forever Hitler." After a smooth landing, he stepped out and went through customs. He hid among a group of British diplomats. For once, his rubber skull cap of thick black pubic hair and languid vaginas, laced with cuckoo spit, passed among the bowler hats without comment. In the airport lounge beneath the harsh neon lights, the red knobs of the clitorises pushed between the spongy gray walls of the vaginas, swelling up in imitation of open poppies under a Hollywood sun. He moved quickly to the passenger arrival area. He felt the thrill of his Jewish prince's hat ripple across the dome of his fair scalp. That hat was palpitating. From its rubber base, a trickle of water seeped past the collar of his shirt and continued down his back. He flexed his shoulders, stretching the fabric of his shirt so that it would absorb the juice. New York, Bacteria City. Outside the airport, he waited for a quick moment to get his bearings, then boarded a yellow cab. He had booked a single cheap $90 a day room at the Chelsea. The Chelsea! Hara leant forward, resting his chest on his knee, and tapped the cab driver heavily on the shoulder. "The scenic route." "Sure," replied the bored cabbie. "You want Broadway and 42nd? Times Square?" "No, thanks. That will be later." Hara's cap bulled up and gave off a salty tang. "Take some other route and step on it." The car pulled away and Hara slumped back. Despite the radium to which his system had responded well, he felt weak. His bones ached and he caught the reflection of his arm in the cab window. The white arm protruded from his coat sleeve. He studied its emaciated appearance. The immense heat of New York took some of the chill away, but it did not stop him hearing the bones of his reduced body grinding together. He pressed deeply into the pockets of his ankle-length fox coat and felt as if he was an old mangy lion basking. He wondered whether this would be his first and last trip to America in adult life, although in his heart, he felt that it was not. But if this was to be his final sojourn, he either nailed Hitler or acknowledged to himself that he was chasing a ghost. In the oppressive heat of the cab, Hara sweated. The heat, bouncing between concrete, seemed to center in on him. His vagina hat fired off more cuckoo spit. Instead of flirting around its pubic bed, it overshot, and a load came to rest on the hook of his nose and hung from its tip. He opened his fox fur coat and allowed the spit to fall into his string vest, where it seeped through to the bone of his chest. He lay back, almost unconscious, while the driver complained about the flies that were being attracted to the cab. When Hara came to, a slight breeze from countless hillside cemeteries marginally fluffed the vaginas on his cap. The cab was passing through suburban Queens. For miles, he could see nothing from the speeding car but junkyards and cemeteries, and acres of land given over to roofing and timber and rusting shop signs. Then the hills began to give way to more city, and he was in Manhattan. The cab turned down 23rd Street. While normally the Chelsea Hotel took in long-term residents, it was not a hotel in the accepted sense. He had made arrangements to rent a room, recently vacated by a British celebrity. He had been able to do so on the recommendation of Max Wall, who thought Hara's reputation would blend with the hotel's notorious demi-monde. His first view of it filled him with dismay. It reminded him of one of those huge, deserted, crumbling warehouses near Battersea Power Station. He stood on its steps and read the names of past residents: Thomas Wolfe, James T. Farrell, O. Henry, William Burroughs, Brendan Behan, Dylan Thomas, Sid Vicious? Sid Vicious. The last meant nothing to him. but he had once read in tidbits that Thomas Wolfe liked to regard himself as a giant. Wolfe had taken up residence in the hotel in the mid-1930s because he wanted to live, in his words, among the dwarfish Jew. Hara, too, regarded himself as a mental giant. Inside, he collected his room keys, took the elevator to the second floor, walked along the corridor, and came to room 327. The plaque above the door read, "Quentin Crisp." Hara entered. He was in an almost derelict room. Its walls were visibly covered with a rough cement gray plaster. In parts, the plaster had fallen away, revealing the lats and the bricks beneath. Chunks of cement lay on the floor. The soft desolation of the plaster was covered in places by dowdy green utility wallpaper. The room was plainly furnished with a single bed, two wooden chairs, and a high perspex top table. In one corner stood a large teak cabinet, which looked as if someone had dumped it there. In another lay a chipped enamel zinc tub, upturned and almost buried beneath the pale dust. Above it was a sink made of pot, and next to it, semi-hidden by a screen, a john. There were no windows or other openings apart from the door. It only occurred to him later that he was somewhere in the hub of the Chelsea. Obviously, there would be no windows. He disrobed, folding his fur coat over an old black and white TV set. He pulled off his skull cap. The small suction cups inside the cap relinquished their hold on his scalp with an effort.